I tried to regroup the last few minutes, but I haven't been able to, so I'm going to continue as is. Because it really doesn't matter to me whether I'm emotional or not. Maybe it's time that I show the more emotional side of me, so Americans will understand exactly what the cost is for what we have. As a child of 1987, I had no father, just a mother. A man by the name of Stephen Carey Birch came up out of the clouds and decided he wanted to adopt me and be my dad. Kudos to you, Stephen Birch, because I put you through 21 years of hell. I was never an easy child as I grew up, quite often in trouble. I had four grandparents, Frank and Marie, Eugene and Cora, and Ed and Ruth. Ed and Ruth were a God-fearing couple. Eugene and Cora were the remarry of Eugene and Marie. And Frank and Marie were obviously the remarry of said such. They had split up when they were younger and remarried, so I was blessed. We also had a set of adopted grandparents named Peg and Herm Schonder. They had no one left in their family. They had endured World War II, and they knew what it was like, and they taught me all they could about tough times and the Great Depression. As I grew up older, I started to stay at Grandpa Gene's very rarely because, well, I wasn't a perfect kid. But I vividly remember something that now we can address correctly, but back in 1987 to 1996, while he lived during that short span in my lifetime, was known as night terrors. Very late at night, you would hear Eugene screaming things like "take the hill," or "fall back," or things like that, because he had endured such a massive strike to his mentality from what he had endured in Guam, Guadalcanal, Peleliu, the island of Turk, and Iwo Jima. The hardest part about Grandpa Gene was when he got cancer. At the age of 13, I remember standing there and him telling me about people pulling him through the ground and telling him that it was a zombie story because it sounded like one. Later on, finding out at 30-some-odd years old that it was true and that I had been one of the most arrogant people my entire life and had walked by and said, "Only thank you for your service to most of our veterans," which means you, if you're listening, can change. Gene died in 1996. One of the last things he ever told me was that I would do great things for my country, and I thought it was the craziest thing I ever heard. Because he was so fragile, he couldn't even control his body anymore. He was laying in a bed, in a hospice bed, and this was a man that had a handshake that my 6'4" stepfather, who was now father, would literally get put down on the ground by. When Gene shook you, it was a true Marine handshake. You'd think that the bones in your hand were crushing. To watch this man fade away down to an 80, then maybe 70-pound man, and then pass away and tell me, "Don't worry, that I would do great things for our country," I thought it was crazy. Looking forward, maybe he was right. I don't know. Those of you that serve know more than I do. I just feel like I'm a regular guy trying to make people realize what the difference is between what we have and what we could have. We have people standing out on the front lines of hate, saying, "Surrender to other countries like North Korea." Are you frigging kidding me? They have but one radio station in North Korea. There is no channel-changing button. It is a state-owned radio station. You hear propaganda 24/7. For the last 20 to 30 years, North Korea has been fighting a war against us that they have no proof of other than fake videos. Their people think they are really winning. That's how sad it is. It's similar to Hitler's situation, whom my grandfather fought his people, or his allies, rather, from Japan. It's a really tough ride to see people fall. I want to put my heart out to Elaine and Richard Hasher. Last week, a very close friend who was 85 years old, named Richard Hasher, passed away. He had served our country with dignity. He was extremely tough and extremely expedient in what he did. He was a good man, and his wife was just as sweet as he was. May God bless you, Richard Hasher, wherever you are, and I'm sure it's in heaven. I hope that God gives you wings. And I hope that God watches all over our fighting services tonight and our allies and protects them with all his might. Now moving on to the stories tonight, because I'm in one of those moods. I want to tell you about something from a country I have not mentioned. I haven't mentioned this country because it's a really small country that fell quickly to Hitler, but fought brilliantly. The country is Poland. Quite often I get asked from people from Poland, how do I feel about their country? I have absolutely no animosity towards their country. In fact, I think they're one of the greatest nations ever. For such a small nation, they fight tooth and nail. So do the Finnish. So here's an oddball story about a bear who is actually a soldier. Wojtek the Soldier Bear. For centuries, Poland has been known specifically for two things: badass spicy sausages and getting especially fucked over by every other European nation in every possible way. Polish people are constantly getting about as much respect as the Duke University football program. And the once proud nation has been carved up for more times than Joan Rivers' face. The early days of World War II was no exception, when the unsuspecting, peaceful Poles all of a sudden found themselves getting sneak attacked, double-teamed by the international military superpower dickheads from Germany and the Soviet Union. Sure, the communists and fascists totally hated each other, but apparently they were willing to join forces and work together to oppress the citizens of Poland, steal their land, and imprison anyone they damn well pleased. Of course, we know what the Germans did to the people of Poland, but it certainly wasn't any picnic being on the receiving end of the sickle and hammer, either. Captured Polish POWs that weren't executed on the spot by the rescues were shipped out to hardcore gulags in Siberia, where they spent 12 hours a day eating disgusting borscht and gruel mining snow from ice caves with pickaxes, can't speak tonight, like the dwarves in Snow White, and toiling away in temperatures that never got above negative 50 degrees in the summertime. However, once Germany double-crossed the Soviet Union and started beating the holy living crap out of the Red Army, Joseph Stalin all of a sudden had a change of heart and decided to let captured Polish POWs out of prison so they could help fight for the Allies. Since the Poles weren't too keen on fighting on behalf of the Russians, who had oppressed and imprisoned them, they decided to serve under the British instead. A large number of these men were put on trains. And sent to Iran, where they formed up the Polish Second Army Corps. The corps' first mission was to travel to Palestine, link up with the British 8th Army, and assist in the Allied invasion of Italy. Of course, we know what the Germans... On the trip through Iran, the men of Polish 22nd Transport Artillery Supply Company came across a young Iranian boy wandering through the desert like Jim Morrison tripping balls and carrying a large cloth sack. The men thought the boy looked tired and hungry, so they gave him some food and a crunch bar or some shit. When the kid thanked them, the Poles asked what was in the bag. The boy opened it up and revealed a tiny, malnourished brown bear cub. Since the soldiers knew the little cub was in very poor health and needed attention quickly, they brought the bear from the kid for a few bucks, or whatever the hell they used for money in 1940s Iran, and fed it some condensed milk from a milk makeshift bottle. For the next several days, they nursed it back to health, giving it food, water, and a warm place to sleep. Over the long journey from Iran to Palestine, the bear, now named Wojtek, it's spelled Wojtek in Polish, but pronounced Wojtek because Polish is a crazy language, quickly became the unofficial mascot of the 22nd Company. The bear would sit around the campfire with the men, eating, drinking, and sleeping in tents with the rest of them. The bear loved smoking cigarettes, drank beer right out of the bottle like regular infantrymen, and got a kick out of wrestling and play fighting with other soldiers. Of course, he was the most badass, ass-kicking wrestler in the entire company, thanks in part to the fact that he grew to be 6 feet tall, weighed roughly 500 pounds, and could knock small trees over with a single swing of his massive clawed paw. He grew to be part of the unit, improving the morale of men who had spent several years getting their asses kicked in slave labor camps and was treated as though he were just another hard-drinking, hard-smoking, hard-fighting, hair-growing soldier in the company. When the unit marched out on the mission, Wojtek would stand up on his hind legs and march alongside them. When the motorized convoy was on the move, Wojtek sat in the passenger seat of one of the jeeps, hanging his head out the window and shocking the shit out of people walking down the street. In addition to kicking people's asses and drinking beer, Wojtek also enjoyed taking hot baths for some reason. Over the summer in Palestine, he learned how to work the showers, and you could pretty much always find him splashing around in the bathhouse. Once he entered the bath hut and came across the spy who had been planted to gather intelligence on the Allied camp, he growled, slapped the dude upside his stupid head, and the man immediately crapped his pants and surrendered. The soldier bear was lauded as a hero for successfully capturing an enemy agent who in turn was interrogated and gave up vital intelligence on enemy positions. When it was time to stop screwing around and get in the shit, as they say, two corps linked up with the hardcore British 8th Army and headed out in the middle of Category 5 crap storm that was brewing in Italy. The problem, however, was that the British High Command did not allow pets or animals, so the Polish Army formally enlisted Wojtek the Bear into their ranks. He was given the rank of private, assigned a serial number, and from that point on was included in all official unit rosters. The Brits were like, whatever, chaps, and didn't even bat an eye when Wojtek marched ashore with the rest of the 22nd Company. The Poles' finest hour of the war came in the incredibly bloody battle for Monte Cassino. By the time two corps arrived, the Germans were deeply entrenched in the hilltop monastery, and three previous Allied assaults on the position had all proved more fruitless than a South Florida orange tree in the middle of a worldwide nuclear winter. The campaign was proving to be one of the bloodiest battles of the Western Front, and the Poles were brought in to make the final push to capture the fortress. During the fighting, Wojtek the Hero Bear actually hand-carried boxes of ammo, some weighing in at over 100 pounds, from supply trucks to artillery positions on the front lines. He worked tirelessly, day and night, bringing surprise to his friends who were bravely battling the Nazis. He never rested, never dropped a single artillery shell, and never showed any fear, despite of the position of being under constant enemy fire and heavy shelling. His actions were so inspiring to his fellow soldiers that after the battle, the official insignia of the 22nd Artillery was changed to a picture of Wojtek carrying an armful of howitzer ammunition. In the same vein, you have to assure that it was pretty frigging demoralizing to the Germans to see that the Poles had a giant damn bear fighting on their side. Thanks in part to the heavy shelling by their artillery, the Polish forces broke through the Nazi defenses and captured Monte Cassino. Wojtek and his comrades would go on to fight the Germans across the Italian peninsula, breaking through the enemy lines and forcing the Croats out of Italia for good. After the war, some elements of the Polish army, including Wojtek, were assigned to Scotland, since Poland was under USSR control and many Polish soldiers did not like the prospect of living in a Soviet-run police state. Wojtek lived the rest of his days at the Edinburgh Zoo, where he passed away in 63 at the age of 22. It is said that he always perked up when he heard the Polish language spoken by zoo guests, and during his life in there, he was always being visited by his old friends in the Polish army, some of whom would throw cigarettes down into his open arms, some of whom would even jump onto the bear enclosure and wrestle with him for old time's sake. The idea of an alcoholic, Nazi-fighting bear is so awesome that you'd think it was something out of a bizarre cartoon or sci-fi original movie. It's the sort of shit that, even with all the historical evidence, seems too totally awesome to be true. The bear was a hero of World War II, and there are statues of him and plaques memorializing his brave service in Poland, Edinburgh, the Imperial War Museum in London, and the Canadian War Museum. Unbelievable. Just goes to show that anyone or anything can join a good cause. And now, for a little bit of more good music, as tonight, I should say I'm running a little under the weather. I could have done the show tomorrow, because Big Dog was, well, a little bit off on time tonight, but it's okay. I told him tonight that I wasn't about to change my schedule because none of you change your schedule for me. And I felt that that was more than appropriate, and there's no reason to ever change it. All of you are my friends, my closest compadres. And if you ever need anything, you can contact me. As I always tell you, the address is www.fightforourfreedom.com. I want to give special thanks to Madison Rising tonight and the following four people. During the course of running Fight for Our Freedom, I've struggled quite often with having donors. Only four people have stepped out of the cloud in literally 3 years. They are the following. Number one, David Nichols of Indianapolis, Indiana. Number two, Robin Cook of Clearwater, Florida. Number three, Cassidy Bollinger in North Carolina, sorry. And number three, my buddy named Christopher, who I totally went blank on, and I apologize for that. Both of them, or all of them, rather, are great allies of our nation and what we do, and those